From the heart of Manhattan, this is Classic Talk.
Welcome to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we are coming to you from the art studio of Mr. Ben Schonzeit here in Soho of New York City. Ben is one of the leading painters in New York and in America. It was one of the foremost pioneers of the 1970 photorealist movement. Welcome, Ben.
Hi.
Well, thank you for letting us come to your shrine. And
it's my pleasure.
And this is, I feel like it's like everything is so, I don't know how to describe it. It's just so wonderful. And how long you been here now?
I've been in this loft since 1972. Which is, I think, a long time ago now.
That was a few years ago.
40 years. It'll be 40. It's 40 years. Almost 40 years.
1972, a lot was going on in your field. Am I correct in saying that was sort of the beginning of photorealism?
Or? Well, photorealism started in the late 60s with a few other artists, Malcolm Morley, Chuck Close, maybe in 1970, I was doing it at the same time. But people have always worked with photographs. It goes back a long way. Degas worked with photographs, for example. He was a photographer.
If you were to give a definition of what photorealism really is, how would you say it?
It's hard to say what photorealism is. I mean, to be honest, I don't think of myself as a photorealist. I think of myself as an artist who works with photographs. Somewhere around 1970-something, in the early 70s, Lou Mizell came up with the word photorealism. And at that time, there were a lot of people working with photographs. It was, I think the impetus for the work was post-pop. You know, there were Rosenquist and the pop artists, Andy Warhol, Rauschenberg were all using photographs in their work. And the next generation of painters started seeing photographs, taking photographs seriously as source material, and painting paintings that looked very much like photographs. But that's it did start, the movement started, I guess, 70, 72.
And it was a New York, it was American movement, but was it specifically New York? Or?
Well, there were artists in New York, and then there were a bunch of people in California. So you had Bechtel and McLean and Goings, I think, in California. And in New York, you had me and Chuck Close and Malcolm Morley and Cottingham and who else? Tom Blackwell. Ron Kleeman, a bunch of Don Eddy, who was from California, came to New York. But
during the last 40 years, mm-hmm. do you see any changes or differences?
In photorealism?
Yes.
Well, I'm seeing now a bunch of younger artists who are working from photographs who in some ways are better.
Hmm. You know, why look is that?
I'm not involved with detail. I mean, things that I do generally have to do with a certain range of focus and depth of field, and right. and the foundation of my work is very atmospheric and based often on color. So if I paint green apples, it's really all about green. We already know what apples mm-hmm. look like. Mm-hmm. But what I'm seeing now in the next generation of photorealists, and there's some extremely talented people whose names I don't remember. I don't really know these guys. I've met a bunch of them. Yeah. And they're people who do extraordinarily detailed work. You know, they really have tremendous patience. They have kind of classical training and traditional skills that I just don't have.
I thought you were already very, very detail oriented. I
mean, no. I mean, okay.
You really talking about they are more even more deeper, I mean, in detail?
What you have with my work, I think, is that it appears to be detail. It appears to have a lot of detail, but in fact, it's generally fairly blurry. You know, if you look up close.
Right, sure.
Whereas there are people now doing things where you see every little hair and they use these little teeny brushes. And there are some amazing painters out there working from photographs to make things that look very much like, you know, most people think it looks just like a photograph, but photographs don't do what paintings do, no matter how much it resembles a photograph. Paintings are different.
But the attention to such detail is probably paralleled in photography with current digital photography, which is so incredibly digital. Is that true? I mean, so detailed.
Film is generally sharper than digital, actually, if it's done right, and you have a big enough piece of film. Generally, you see more detail. You're more aware of the detail in digital stuff now. And with digital, you can get much more information than you can comfortably get with film. The things that I can do with a digital camera now, I couldn't do with film. So shadow detail and highlight detail and all contrast, all these things, control of color. You can be very creative in how you process the digital file and shape it. I shape my photographs. I make them the paintings I want to make. What it really looks like, you know, it's very close to what I wind up with, but it really is my attitude towards the material to shape the illusion.
Do you always use your own photographs, or do you see someone else's photograph and paint from that?
In the photorealist work, I do a lot of different things, many too many different things. In the photorealist works, I work from pictures which I take, always. But in some of the more complicated sort of composite paintings, layered paintings, where there's a flower girl and some hand and maybe a little balcony and some people dancing off in the sky, some of those pictures may come from other sources, magazines, newspapers, historical pictures.
The reason you want to use your own photographs is because artistically that you feel that that's yours?
No. Well, the reason I use my own photographs is that when I take, my photographs are different from anyone else's photographs, and I take pictures looking for a certain spatial quality, certain colors, certain everything. Nobody photographs like me that I know of.
Okay.
And so
could
I
you,
need to.
Yeah. Could
I
you
need
just.
To use, Yeah. Could I just articulate what that is?
Yes. Yes.
First, I mean, I'll talk about my eye because it shapes my work. Uh-huh. I have one eye. I lost my eye when I was 5 years old, fooling around with a very sharp object.
Mm.
And so I perceive depth differently from other people. And I also have a narrower peripheral vision. Most people, you know, when they see off to one side, they see a wide area, and then on the other side, they see another wide area. I see my nose.
Uh-huh.
So that I tend to see squares. Then, partially how I determine where things are in space has to do with focus. If I look at you, Bing, what's behind you goes out of focus because your brain doesn't accept it. I can't look at you and look at the painting behind you and have it be in focus. Mm-hmm. And I've used that element, it's become a part of my work because that's how I see. That they're mostly squares or squarish rectangles has to do with that's the way I see. You know, I see like this and most people see like that. So the world for me is like that. And I'm fascinated with how things appear. So when I paint something, I'm generally looking for the truth about it, but I'm not looking for every little pimple and
right.
You know, and thing. And even with an artist like Chuck Close, in his early work, very, very realistic, they're really very, very abstract. It's not really what things look like. And I come from an abstract background. All, whatever I do that's figurative, I figured out on my own. I didn't study it. And when I see people now, I see some of these very, very skilled new photorealists who went through the academy or studied in Italy or are restorers or something and are really, really have chops when it comes to oil paint. I just don't have that. I just fake it.
No.
You know, I made it up. I'm an autodidact.
Do you like that? You know, the way they did it.
Do I like what they do?
Uh-huh.
Sure.
Why?
Yeah. Well, I'm impressed. It's beautiful.
Uh-huh.
You know, a couple of these people are fantastic painters. I think they're more, I don't see myself as a realist. I think my work is very abstract. It's equally apples and green or red, orange, and yellow as much as it is whatever that subject might be. And so the subject can vary very widely. Right now, I'm working on an exhibition for California that opens on January 12th at Jonathan Novak Gallery, put that in. And now I'm not painting one painting, then painting another painting, another painting. I'm now painting a suite of paintings that I want to relate. I'm painting the room. So we're going to have 5 or 6 large paintings and maybe 10 smallish paintings. And I, thematically, I want it to all go together.
To relate.
Mm-hmm. Which is a struggle for me.
What is the theme, if you could give it away?
This will be food.
Food.
Mostly. So the rooster on the wall behind me, I think it qualifies as food, but I don't think it's going to be in the show. I think it'll go... It may be at the gallery, or it may go to a different gallery someplace else. I don't know.
I see you do a lot of food.
Yeah, I have.
And is that something that you really enjoy doing that, or just happened to be?
I got into it. I stopped doing photorealism, or what? I stopped doing fruit and vegetables, which was what I was best known for many, many years ago. And then there was a show at the Guggenheim in Berlin of older work. Photorealism in the 70s, or I don't know what they called it. And a painting that I had done in maybe in 74, 75, of cauliflower was there, and I looked at it, and I thought it was fantastic. Uh-huh. And I'd been working with the airbrush doing other things. I'd done some portraits, and I hadn't worked with the airbrush for years, and then I brought it out for some things that I just didn't know how to do any other way. And I looked at this thing, and I said, you know, I don't think I'm finished with that. You know, I did red peppers a long time ago. I did rhubarb. I did whatever, a bunch of different things. And I felt, well, I should finish that off. You know, I'm going to use up all of those. I'm going to do those other things that I didn't get around to doing. And started, and I thought, you know, I never did blueberries. And so I did blueberries. And that was kind of exciting. And then it was fun. And then I did some apples, and someone came over here because I wanted to know how to price it. A dealer who was a friend of mine came by, and I wanted to know how to price this painting. It was different and very much like what I had used to do, and what I had done, is how we say it in English. And I said, well, what should I ask for this thing? He said, I don't know, but do you want a check or do you want cash? So I wanted a check. I didn't know how to hide that much money comfortably. It was nice amount of money. But so I got involved with this, and I'm now having this show. I may have another show of these things. But I've got an image, you know, I work from photographs, so I have some idea what I might be doing. And the latest thing that came along that really excited me is three cauliflowers and a bunch of red onions at a farm stand in Solvang, California, where we just were a week ago. I saw this thing and I didn't know it was potentially a great painting. I just took a picture. And then when I came back and went through all my material, I saw this picture. I said, you know, this has something I've never done before. This is interesting. So I'm going to do it. It's going to be terrible pain in the neck because January 12th is coming up very soon.
Very good.
but I want to do this, so I'm
what gonna... do you mean by you have never done that before?
Well, because the show is in January, and January is really coming very quickly, because the larger paintings, 6 by 6 feet
Sure.
How long?
Take about 6-8 weeks.
6-8 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's about all the time I have.
Do you think, you know, doing...
Or 2 weeks, depending upon how much time I spend on the computer.
Right. Doing your kind of painting and the abstract, as far as time goes, any difference? You know, you say, well, because what you do is so detail-oriented. You know, you're talking about layers, you're talking about colors, you're talking about
lights. They're complicated puzzles.
Yeah, very complicated. So you think that will be a lot more time consumed than the abstract?
I do so sort of abstract work. I do watercolors, which are kind of cubist, and you don't see any. There's some around, but you've seen them. Mm-hmm. And really, they take a very, very long time, too, because they're all of these paintings, the actual painting doesn't take that much time. It's the complexity of assembling images. My new abstract paintings are these stripe paintings here. And those are done while I'm doing the realist paintings. And they're just all about color and stripes, and they have some history and so on. But it's my hobby.
Has there been an exhibition?
Not yet. And every time I do a batch of them, my wife takes them out to the house in the country, and I can't. And if Miriam likes them, they must be good.
Must be good.
But I know dealers have, no one's seen them. But also, I've had a place to show them. I have some people in mind, and when I'm through with my show, I might go and show some of these. I have some people over to look at them, because I like them. I don't know if they're good or they're bad, but I like them, and that's enough for me.
Now, you're talking about this, and, you know, let's go back to, say, Renaissance times and all that. Now, do you consider that also some kind of a realism?
No. I'm really not into, you know, like, realism. It is. I mean, you have a guy like Durer or Holbein, you know, or Bruegel. They're amazing. But I'm on Facebook. And on Facebook, there are a couple of art historians that somehow we found each other. Or I found them. They didn't find me. And they're putting up pictures of Renaissance paintings, you know, these things that you see in churches that I walk by. Mm-hmm. Or the rooms at the Met that I walk through.
Right.
You know, I don't look at some, you know, Christ and the Moneylenders, right. You know, Wall Street, reference to Wall Street. And now I'm seeing them online, and these guys are amazing. They're beautiful, they're abstract, they're original. And in the abstract work that I do, which is, it's cubist sort of, and it's figures and rooms and curtains and landscapes, and, you know, it's they're pictures. And I'm looking at how Masaccio arranged something wherever he is in Italy when I went and I looked at it, but I didn't get it, you know. And now I look at it because I've been sort of doing things which are similar, very flat, layered, structured, patterned things. And I'm loving these things. It's a great discovery. But I don't know, it's art, you know. I don't think realism, I think people will always make things that refer to the experience of life, the experiences of life, of being a human being, of moving through this time that we are given. And artists hope that what we do will resonate as adequately universal for people to see it and relate to it over time. One of the, maybe I'm digressing, but this whole thing is a digression anyway. That one of the reasons I started doing fruit and vegetables, so on, many years ago, was that I was looking for a subject that wouldn't change. That, you know, an apple's always more or less going to look like an apple. And if I look back on my earlier work of certain things, I'm realizing now that, in fact, it's not true. That you would go to a market and there would be a certain kind of orange, and it was really kind of a mess. And now, all the oranges are perfect. You know?
Yes.
And It's so the world has changed. So it's you know, it's interesting that what is timeless. You know, you take somebody, you stand them up in the middle of a room, you have them take off their clothes. You know, more or less, we've all more or less looked the same for thousands of years. Beyond that, everything's changing.
It's very unfortunate. That's true to everything in the modern society. They make everything bigger and really so-called perfect, and you lose all that taste and even look.
Things change, yeah. But yeah. There's also a movement back towards...
Now, talking about change, you know, during the last 400 or 500 years, you know, the artist painting from, you know, one period of time to the other, do you think it really changed that much in a sense?
There have been big changes. There were big changes in the 19th century. Before that, I mean, early on, you know, really... Through the Renaissance, most work that survives was commissioned work. You work for the church, you work for a patron, you work for this, you work for that. Just same as music. Exactly. Anything that lasted like that. And now you have independent artists. You know, we paint it, we hope someone will buy it. And you have dealers, brokers of work and so on. And that started in Europe in the 19th century when, you know, a guy like Van Gogh would go off to Arles and paint a bunch of pictures and see, hope that someone would buy them and hope that his brother would send him paint and money so he could live. You know, but that's
never changed, right?
That hasn't changed, no. No, but my brother has never sent me any money. My sister has sent me money. Not in many years, but...
Speaking of your family,
yes.
Going way back, did you always paint? Did you paint as a small child? I heard that you painted big murals in school.
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. No, so, I was always, you're looking at class artist. I was doing, in the fifth grade, I was doing Santa Claus and sleighs and reindeer across all the windows in the classroom. You know, a room is about 40 feet long. And I would paint, you know, these murals on the windows and stuff. Yeah, I was good.
What about your teacher?
I don't do anything else. You know,
your teacher always say, you're going to be an artist.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I was always the artist. You know, I passed courses that I didn't have a clue about by doing drawings that the teacher could put up on the wall. And he said, well, if you do this, I'll pass you.
Yeah, well, did you influence it by your family or your parents or anything?
No, certainly not my friends. We had paintings in the house. My parents collected paintings. So I grew up in a house with some real, mostly Dutch paintings.
Right.
Early 20th century Dutch paintings that look a little bit like Corot, but a well-known painter.
Your parents encouraged your path? Or?
Yeah, until I got serious about it.
Until you got serious.
Yeah, I was an artist. I never decided to be an artist.
Okay.
I decided to be an architect.
Hold that note. We're going to try to find out more about that.
We need to take a break. We'll be right back. We're here in the studio of Ben Schonzeit in Soho in New York City on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.